Johnny. Johnny.
Sweetheart. Well, yeah, I'm gonna tell you. Listen, honey, listen.
I want you to know something, sweetheart. I've done something so bad.
Welcome to TCM Slumberground, the pregame show for TCM Underground. My name is Millie DeCherico. I am your TCM Underground programmer and your host for this show. I am joined, as always, by my esteemed TCM colleagues. I'm here with Ben, Toya, and Matthew. Tonight, we're going to discuss Wild at Heart from 1990. The film was based on a novel by Barry Gifford, which is basically a series of books that he wrote that features Sailor and Lula as the protagonist. How to describe Wild at Heart? I mean, quite honestly, it's like if Southern Gothic met speed metal. It's like a comedy meets a road movie, meets a horror film, meets Wizard of Oz. And honestly, I think David Lynch pretty much said it best when he said that this movie is about, quote, finding love in hell, which I think is kind of the most perfect description for it, and also about a lot of his movies. So I don't know. I know our panel has a lot to say about it. So let me go to Matthew first. So explain to me like what you find fascinating about Dave Lynch as a director.
I feel like he captures dreams really succinctly on screen. And, you know, I say dreams, but I really more mean nightmares. And then there's sort of these kind of waking, you know, when you're kind of like half asleep and you're sort of waking up and you just, you don't know what's real and you don't know what's fake and what's, you know, part of your dream still. And it's just, he's really good at capturing that time of just sort of like slowly re-entering the waking world. And I know that kind of plays a, you know, a part in some of his movies, especially like Mulholland Drive. But I think he's just so good at that and just making his just worlds just be like these like nightmare sort of dreamscapes. And I think that's just something that's really awesome about him.
Good. So we're all, I guess it makes sense that we're all in our adult pajamas getting ready to watch a movie that's essentially going to be a living nightmare. We all have drinks, by the way. I should point that out. These are little nightcaps. But yeah, that to me is, I think, a definitely an interesting thing about David Lynch as well. Just the vibe of it. I mean, it just, like, especially with Wild at Heart, it definitely feels like an actual nightmare where you're like moving from scene to scene and there's all these like weird transitions and like fire and all this stuff. Ben, where do you see like Wild at Heart amongst David Lynch's other films? Do you like it more? Do you like it less? Where is it for you on the?
It's hard to say. I mean, I feel like it's actually one of his easier to follow along with. I think of it as like his like cowpunk road movie, where he like wanted to do some kind of like rock and roll industrial movie. It feels like of that era. Like 1990 was very much a industrial
speed metal era.
Yeah, it's like speed metal. Wax Tracks Records in Chicago, like, it feels like a revolting cock song come to life. So, like, I kind of love it for that. You know, despite Nicolas Cage being the star, it's one of my favorite David Lynch movies.
Do you have something personal against Nicolas Cage? Unlike the internet, who loves him completely and always has something.
I like him in Valley Girl and this.
I will say, I think it's interesting that in this movie, he's probably the least interesting thing about the movie.
Yeah.
Very sure.
Yeah, he's kind of just a vessel for everyone else. I mean, somebody has to be like the least weird, if that's a, or least interesting.
His jacket upstages him. I'll say that.
His jacket? Yeah, the loose.
Well, that was his idea, apparently.
Oh, well, it was a good, that was a good idea.
It was, he insisted on wearing the snakeskin, and I was like, okay.
I mean, I dug it as a sign of his personal individuality and personal freedom. So,
hey, my snakeskin jacket! Thanks, baby. Did I ever tell you that this here jacket represents a symbol of my individuality and my belief in personal freedom?
About 50,000 times.
Also, it's interesting that you talk about it coming from a specific place in time, because it's also, that's the thing I think about David Lynch in general, is that he kind of has this like weird obsession with like 50s America, but it's all being viewed from like an 80s and 90s perspective, which is personally kind of like a trope that I love. I love specifically 80s and 90s that movies that sort of take place or an homage to 50s and 60s movies. And to me, especially I think with the acting, it's so like speed metal meets like Tennessee Williams film adaptation. So Toya, we're sidebarring right now with Toya, because here's the thing. Toya mentions to me, we're like talking about doing this episode, and Toya mentions to me that she's actually like not exactly a David Lynch fan. And I think that that's awesome and interesting, and we got to talk about it. So, had you ever seen Wild at Heart before you saw it?
No, this was this is the one that everybody that I know, and I've been watching or attempting to watch his movies since I was like 16. I mean, it's been like half of my life of trying to get him. And everybody was saying, oh, but you'll love Wild at Heart. This is like his most like accessible one. You'll love this one. And yeah, no.
Okay, so that's interesting.
Which one did you watch first?
So the first one I saw was Blue Velvet. And I was like, what is this? I enjoyed the performances. I remember Dennis Hopper being my favorite thing about it. I remember the colors being very pretty. But outside of that, I was just like, okay, not for me, but I'll try again. I did Mulholland Drive again. Beautiful colors, beautiful imagery. And then the little dude comes out of the box and I was just like, what the f- am I watching? What is this? And then I've yet to see Eraserhead. I feel like I'll probably like it for what it is, but yeah. So this one I was excited because I love Nick Cage. I don't love new school Nicolas Cage because I feel like now he's just stick. He's like a caricature of himself, but I feel like everything that he's done in the past, I was a big fan of. So I was excited about this one. And immediately 5 minutes in, I said out loud, oh, I hate this. I was like, no, be open-minded, let's try this. And so I drank a little bit more and then I continued to watch it. And it's, weirdly enough, I do like it. I do think that this is probably one of my favorite of the Lynch films that I've seen. But, and I'm still trying to process my own personal reactions around it, because I do like it, but I still hate it. And like, I don't know what that is.
I think you like David Lynch, you just don't know it. Like, that's everyone's reaction is, I don't get it, I kind of hate it, I love it, it looks good, it's fun. I mean, so I think you are a David Lynch fan.
Never but responded well to the humor in his movies.
What do you do? Do you watch this movie and not laugh? What do you do?
It's, I for some reason with David Lynch, I like the darker aspects to his movies. You know, I like, you know, for Twin Peaks, for example, I like the central mystery and sort of the, for you know, the, what am I trying to say? The some kind of foreboding and just sort of eeriness behind it more than I like the quirkiness of, you know, the townspeople. And I know that's very sort of different than a lot of people feel about his work, but for some reason, I just, the stuff that's more haunting to me, I respond to more. And I think that's why I actually like Fire Walk With Me. This is, you guys are going to freak out, but I actually like Fire Walk With Me, the movie, better than I like the show Twin Peaks.
I know people that feel that way. And I got to tell you, when I first saw Fire Walk With Me, I was like, what am I watching? It only took like, I had to basically watch the entire show again and then watch the movie again to really kind of understand, because there's a lot to that movie that is, it relies on you really knowing the show a lot. And so I think I enjoyed it once I sort of put it in the context of the show a little bit more, but as a standalone film, and you gotta imagine people walked into that movie kind of not knowing what it was. And, you know, that's the risk you take as a filmmaker, I guess, basing a movie on a TV show. But it's like, yeah, it's, I think a lot of people view it, or viewing it differently, especially now, I think, with a lot lot of time.
That is what I really respect about him as a filmmaker, though. And I've always felt this way about him as a filmmaker. And even now watching Wild at Heart, this made me kind of realize it a lot more. Just to be so confident in what you're doing that you don't question how, what other people are going to think. It's almost like a legitimate, I don't care if you get it or you don't, because this is what I want to see on the screen. Like, that's admirable. And I love that it's caught fire, pun intended, the way that he has, like, with just kind of within the cult movie fandom. And I think that that's what's so interesting about Lynch. But I mean, again, it's like, legitimately, I will watch another movie of his out of curiosity. But the entire time, I will roll my eyes and go, what is
this? No, I totally respect that. I am certainly not one of those people that's like, well, it's because you didn't do it right. It's because you didn't watch this. It's because you didn't do this. I mean, I'm not going to be prescriptive in you liking somebody or not. You know, it's like, to me, I had that same, you know, experience where it finally clicked for me in some way. And I won't say that it made me like a super fan necessarily, but it definitely made me like understand the world of at least a significant portion of his films were in. But yeah, I actually love that you're like, meh, on this guy. Like, I love that. I think that that's totally healthy, like, film discourse. It's what real film people are like, and love it. Like, you know, you try. That's the best part.
With Lynch, I think, like, for me, liking a lot of the superficial stuff, like the music, the style, the like genre homages, like that has a lot to do with like if I enjoy it. I can put up with a lot of his like bullshit that doesn't make sense if I'm just liking the tone and the music. And people can get, you know, you can have arguments about what the dream logic is and that, and to me, I never care. I'm like, I just kind of tune that stuff out.
What I come to it as is, I think I'm with Ben, where I feel like, you know, we're I kind of love the like high camp nostalgia melodrama of it all, but again, it's not for everyone. So all right, so now I have a question for the entire panel. We'll start with Ben. Which one of the characters in Wild at Heart stands out to you the most? Like, I don't know if you would call it your favorite, but just one that stands out to you.
I mean, I guess like maybe the one I identify most with is Laura Dern as Lula. I'm always gonna fall for a bad guy that wants to take me on a road trip on the crime spree and let me jump out of the car and dance on the side of the road. I really identify with that part. I'm like, I want to do that. I have a fantasy of wanting to be Laura Dern in that movie.
Aww. Well, maybe not all the terrible things that have happened to her, but certainly the outfits.
I mean, I don't want to run into Bobby Peru, but, you know, I like a deserted motel on the side of nowhere. Like, yeah, there's a lot I would dig for her.
Awesome. All right, Matthew, you're up. What about you? Which one of these characters is the most memorable for you?
Probably, this is a small one, but Sherilyn Fenn, who shows up in the car accident scene, is just, if I think of all of David Lynch's movies, that is the scene that bothers me the most out of any of them. And it just affects me every single time I watch it. And I think it's because she doesn't know what's happening to her, and she's got this head wound, and she's bleeding everywhere, and she's just saying all these things, and it's just so sad to me. And I just, every time, it really gets me, and I, you know, almost start to cry a little bit. But it's just such a great scene, and it brings in the lipstick, even, that's sort of a theme throughout the movie. So, you know, it's just, I don't know, just that scene really sticks with me.
All right, Toya, you're up next. Your favorite or / most memorable character in Wild at Heart?
Bobby Peru. Willem Dafoe with that gigantic face of his that's just all gums and disgusting tiny teeth. It's so weird and yet kind of hot. I don't know why I'm into him, and I kind of...
That is the Willem Dafoe way. He is like somehow attractive but playing disgusting people with bad teeth, like, yeah, all over.
But you're still kind of, hey, Willem Dafoe.
But okay, Bobby, what's up? So that made me very uncomfortable, but very, he very similar to Dennis Hopper in Blue Velvet. I like just these almost intense out there performances that they kind of bring to it. And just, yeah, I don't know. Willem's so great in that role. He's so perfect.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's obviously a Lynch thing where the bad guys are like really bad and scary, terrifying. I mean,
yeah.
To me, I know that Bobby Peru is probably second to the Crispin Glover cameo where he plays like the cousin that puts roaches in his butt or whatever. And I mean, again, like another character that kind of just comes out of nowhere and reveals something totally ridiculous and crazy. But yeah, so if I had to choose a character, it would either be the Crispin Glover character, but that Bobby Peru, man, like.
If he puts on the pantyhose, then I'm out.
Yeah.
True. If once the pantyhose goes on, no, I dry up, it's all done.
Can I ask you guys about one thing? How insane do you think it is that Diane Ladd had an Oscar nomination for this movie?
I think it's outrageous. I mean, it's so awesome, but I'm like, I think about the Oscars now, and I'm like, I can't imagine
the 90s ever,
even, like, they wouldn't even give that movie like this a second look, let alone nominate somebody for it.
Do you know who she lost to that year? Whoopi Goldberg in Ghost.
And what? That was the same year as Ghost. Yeah. Wow.
Crazy. She's
really good in it, though. Diane Ladd is so good in that performance.
Yeah.
Oh, her nails are like such a treasure. I'm like, man.
What is happening to her hair? I guess it's just changing every scene. Like, I just, everything. And then there's a moment where she has this curly wig on that doesn't even seem like it should be there because it's a scene that's a flashback.
Wigs were all her ideas. She wanted to do those.
Did she?
Wow. Yeah. I can't remember. Like, she wanted to be like homages to different actresses and stuff.
See, but
I like the ribbon when she's putting on the lipstick on her face and she's got the ribbon in her hair. That's a great look.
That makes me want to work with him, though, because that, how freeing is that? That you're just like, oh, I have this idea. I want to try this. And he's like, yeah, sure, go for it.
Bring her your snakeskin jackets, bring her wigs.
You want to get an Oscar nomination.
Bumper party.
Exactly.
All right. Well, so I know we're running out of time and we got to wrap things up, but I have to ask, since you guys are all TCM employees, we've all been at the network at various lengths of time and we've all been fans for a very long time. So I think we're good people to measure. How many letters and phone calls do you think we're going to get about Wild at Heart?
The amount of letters we're going to get is the amount of times I ask what the f*** is happening in this movie. So that is 17 times before I stopped an hour and 15 minutes in.
Fair enough. Well, I know we're out of time. So I just want to thank my always fun and always insightful TCM colleagues, Ben, Toy, and Matthew. And I just have to say, thank you so much for watching TCM Slumberground. Bye. Oh.